2017 elections now open. 2012 election service providers renew calls for payment. And nominations open in sounds, color and numbers.
This is National MTV News with Helen Sayer.
Good evening and thank you for joining me for Thursday's news. Nominations for candidates contesting the 2017 national general election opened as of 4 o'clock this afternoon. In the morning, Governor General Bob Dadai signed the issue of writs to mark the start of the elections.
The signing of the 111 issue of writs marks the start of Papua New Guinea's 2017 national election period, which will run for 3 months. The writs were issued in the presence of electoral officers and foreign diplomats acting as election observers.
To hold and conduct the general election for the 9th National Parliament. 1. Call of nomination, 4 p.m. today, Thursday, 20 April 2017. 2. Close of nomination, 4 p.m. next Thursday, 27 April 2017.
The Governor General has signed 111 writs for the 111 seats of Parliament, 22 for the provincial seats and 89 for open electorates. So what that means is literally the election starts as of today.
A number of concerns surrounding the election were also addressed by Commissioner Gamato today. They include security operations, foul plays, and the setting up of polling venues.
As much as possible, we want to go and provide that service. It's our responsibility to go and set up the polling place and conduct the election.
For security, Gamato says he is happy with how the operations were planned and is confident members of the three disciplinary forces will ensure a safe and secure election.
I'm satisfied as far as security is concerned, as long as they give us a guarantee that there will be a special unit providing security, a response unit, as soon as possible. So using the intel, if there is incidents that is going to happen, they must deal with that quickly.
Nominations will close on April 27th and polling is expected to start on 24th June 2017.
We were expecting 10,000, but people came in numbers to complete Form 29. And as I'm speaking, over 4,000 candidates have expressed interest by completing Form 29 and have submitted to us. And so with the reduction or going back to 1,000 kina, I think a lot more people will still come.
Thekla Gunga, National MTV News.
While the writs have been issued, service providers to the 2012 elections are still calling for their outstanding claims. MTV was at the Electoral Commission headquarters this morning and found a group of people demanding answers.
They are from different parts of the country, all demanding an end to a five-year-long wait.
I want my payment. Nothing else. Nothing. I want my payment.
They provided services in the last general elections in 2012, and with the issue of writs today, they demand to be paid their dues. Their services range from hire cars, storage facilities for ballot papers, venues for counting and catering services.
Me blog Kapala Eastern Islands. Car blog me all been using 2012 national election. Na car I'm all using them Land Cruiser open bag. All talking blog 800 kina per day. Lo using one per day, so me give carbon me. Only to go see me mangelo place. Only to go see na using this la carbon for 3 months. Start na finish lo election only using this la carbon. The time all I pay out all to come to 2013 bank give him. Me start lo slab you go 2014. You gonna me come down lo year. Triple time you go come lo year lo using this la money. Me wait anta you go all to come to go down lo most be no go see me. Me come lo all to get money no got money. You gonna now 2017 now. Me play around me me la talk Olsen. You like him. Government like road him go play election now 2017 finish this last standing past time. Me play online place we go kiss me play. Na me la to talk on na play cambia in 2017 all like providing service. Outstanding will stop yet. No can give him car, house, catering service, no can make him. Government no got money.
I was given the engagement letter. for my truck to be hired. Then I have all the documents. I can't see the reason why I'm not paying. It's only lousy money. Compared to the other service provider, mine is just lousy. They can't even pay me. I want my payment.
We've been fronting up this office day in, day out, every day for the last 4 years, 5 years. It's very, very frustrating.
5 years.
Don't let me phone these little commissioner officers right across the country. They will be facing some very, very tough times. Mm-hmm. If they have to go out and start trying to engage service providers again, it will be a big problem.
We are citizens. Our legitimate services, which has been given to the commission, and me come back again also. You buy non-up, you same face long come, give them services again, lo yumi, and buy you same. So clean us out, and then go to the fresh one, and have no debts.
Earlier this morning, after the issue of writs, Electoral Commissioner Patilius Gamato said right now he does not have the budget to settle outstanding claims.
The money the government has given me is to conduct the election, is to conduct the 2017 election. In my budget submission to government in 2016, I submitted for outstanding bills, but the government did not allocate funds for the outstanding bills. So I cannot use the 2017 funds for the election to pay outstanding, because if I start doing that, then all the money will go to outstanding bills and I cannot finish the election. Okay, so I said, unfortunately, I cannot pay until the government allocates specific funds to pay outstanding.
Sarah Aupong, National MTV News.
Transparency International Papua New Guinea will be part of the election observers for this year's elections. They have plans to cover all 22 provinces and are now calling for volunteers to be part of their team of observers. Sarah Aupong caught up with the coordinator of this program, Wala Ola, earlier today.
TIPNG's election program started before the issue of writs. Right now, TIPNG is gearing up for the observer part of their program.
A lot of our efforts will be based on doing observations during the polling period. For instance, we will be looking at things like whether the polling booths have been set up on time, that will be and enclosed on time in at the polling stations. We'll be looking at whether the officials there have enough materials to be able to do their work there.
With the intention to cover all the 22 provinces, they need volunteers.
Which means that we will be engaging between 350 to 400 volunteers. We are encouraging a lot of young people and the general public to participate on a voluntary basis on actually doing the observations during the polling period.
Those interested to be part of the TIPNG observer team can contact them on phone or email. Other observers in this year's elections includes heads of missions and the Commonwealth Secretariat. Sarah Aupong, National MTV News.
Sitting MP Justin Tachenko is campaigning for the Moresby South seat in a bid to reclaim his seat. Today, a crowd in the thousands paraded around the electorate and gathered at the Sir Hubert Murray. While the numbers were significant, there are other candidates vying for this seat.
From the air, the numbers that followed Justin Tachenko are significant, but they don't represent the whole electorate. From Kaugere, then to Badili, from Badili to the Sir Hubert Murray Stadium. His supporters' numbers as the first to nominate for Moresby South appeared intimidating for those challenging him for the seat. Even from the sea, people came to show their support to the sitting Member of Parliament. This is by far the biggest show of support today. Similar scenes are expected around the country after the issue of rights today. If anything, today is the start of the country's political games. Bethany Harriman, National MTV News.
Sitting Member of Parliament for Lae, Lujaya Koza, was the first to register her nomination for the Lae open seat soon after the election officials declared the start of elections at 4 o'clock this afternoon. Koza is up against more than 45 intending candidates, but she says she is confident of coming back for another term.
The start of this election has been relatively quiet compared to previous elections. No loud hailers, no large crowds. This afternoon, when the sitting MP for Lae Lujaya Khoza came to register her nomination for the Lae open seat, a small crowd of supporters gathered. Inside, she signed the documents marking her entry into the political race.
I'm just excited at this opportunity. It's a democratic one. I'm not losing sleep at night. I know that my work speaks for itself, but, you know, the media has not covered me at all during the 5 years properly, so you really don't know what I've done.
And Khoza is one of three women candidates in parliament. She was sacked from government ranks after protesting over the delays in setting up the Lae City Authority.
I've done my hard yards, I've been rubbished, I've been ridiculed, and I've come out on top, because everything that's been said about me has been a lie.
Khoza says if given a second term, she will pursue the implementation of the Lae City Authority with aims to improve service delivery in Lae City. She is up against 45 other candidates who are expected to register in the coming days. Scott Wydie, National MTV News, Lae.
The Ombudsman Commission has placed a conditional freeze on DSIP and PSIP accounts. The directive takes effect today and will cover the entire election period. Chief Ombudsman Michael Dick says this is to ensure development funds are not abused during the election period.
The directive goes to all sitting MPs, including provincial administrators and the governor of the Bank of PNG.
Because what we are basically doing is, by the direction, one, we are trying to protect the members from being cited as bribery if they're doing things during the election period. And two, is to protect the proper and right use of the public funds. So we expect all the persons to comply and to cooperate with us so that we don't impede on any of the development efforts that are taking place. All we are doing is ensuring that there is compliance, that there is a rightful and proper use of the public funds.
The watchdog has informed banks of the conditional freeze and will be putting out more information in the coming days.
This direction is a lawful direction, and any person to whom this direction is named is required to comply. Failing that is subject to prosecution.
In order to access these funds, requests must be sent to a committee which includes the Ombudsman Commission and the Department of Implementation and Rural Development, who will vet the request.
Any transaction in those accounts must be within this period, must come to us to clear and ensure that it's going for development projects rather than the MP using it for his own election.
While this directive does not cover the operating accounts in districts and provinces, office holders are warned that transferring of development funds to operating accounts for ease of access will not be tolerated.
This direction, like I said, is as good as a command, and it is for every one of those persons, including the provincial governors, district members, Minister for Rural Development, and the provincial administrators, district administrators, the governor of the Bank of Papua New Guinea, to take note and work with us, because our purpose is to protect these public funds from being used for unintended purposes, especially during this time of the elections.
The directive comes into effect today and ends on October 1st, 2017. Sarah Aupong, National MTV News.
You're with National MTV News. More on election 2017 and the day's other stories after the break. Welcome back. Just a day into elections, PNG Power is once again in turmoil. The union today announced workers would be in a sit-in protest. It comes after calls for their outstanding entitlements and their plea for the government to remove the board went to deaf ears. Two senior members of the management team were suspended, prompting union leaders to come out publicly.
PNG Power is in turmoil again, apparently. The workers' union want the board removed and their outstanding entitlements paid in full.
They've accused the board for neglecting to pay their entitlements, and they've questioned payments made to an electrical company contracted to PPL.
Knowing very well that the board had paid itself, the board had paid $1 million to an electrical company. So the employees have become aware that if the board is feeding itself and forgetting about the workforce, this is the ultimatum now. And the ultimatum is to protest what the board has done, are now going to stop work, and we're now calling on the Prime Minister and the Minister to act on the two letters that were sent to them.
Starting today and now.
Union leaders claim sources in PPL's finance department say the board is signing checks to contractors. They've also made allegations that the board is encroaching on the operational management of PNG Power Limited.
Now the employees are saying, we are now sitting down in protest and we see how good they can address this issue. And the call of the workers is to get rid of the current board and its chairman.
They're now calling for the removal of PPL board chairman Andrew Ogill. Today, members of the union gathered at the PPL headquarters, calling on the government to remove the board. Their action comes after two senior executives were suspended. General Manager Human Resources, Arnold Harriman, and General Manager Customer Services, Upa Minga. Arnold Harriman was dealing with union grievances when he got suspended today, while Upa Minga has been collecting debts for PNG Power. They were part of the management team responsible for PPL's revenue growth in the last 2 years. Neville Choi, National, MTV News.
Two former governors general for Papua New Guinea have been honored with a monument built in their memory. The spectacular shrine is for the late Sir John Guise and the late Sir Kingsford Dibela. The families of both statesmen were present at the blessing of the monument in Dogura in the Milne province.
The monument, built in honor of Sir John Guise and Sir Kingsford Dibela, overlooks one of the most beautiful spots in Milne province. It is located in Dogura, within the premises of the Anglican's majestic chapel of St. Peter and St. Paul. The blessing and dedication of the monument was done on Easter Friday by Bishop Tennyson Boga. The unveiling was done by Deputy Prime Minister Sir Leo Dion and the Minister for National Planning and Monitoring Charles Abel.
Everybody in one way or another have sacrificed to commit themselves and in their small way contribute back to the community. And that is what and how leadership is measured, if you ask me. Leadership is measured in terms of what you give back, the dedication and service. And as the bishop said, as we look into the lives of these two great men here, the most important thing that comes out of it is the reminder of sacrifice and dedication to our people.
Sir John Guise, who passed away in 1991, was PNG's first Governor General. Sir Kingsford Dibela, who passed away in 2002, was the country's third Governor General and second Speaker of Parliament.
The province should be proud for giving Papua New Guinea these two exceptional leaders, whom to this day I have great admiration for. And that is the truth. That's why I'm here. You cannot find any other leaders in this nation. And that is why I said, young leaders, you must emulate, you must tram now, behind him. Just like I'm passing or send, only walking. Passing blow respect. Respect the elders before you.
A headstone was also erected and unveiled for the late Sir Kingsford Dibela on the chapel grounds where his body was laid to rest 15 years ago. This was not done, however, for the late Sir John Guise, who is buried at Lalaura in the central province.
Now it gives me great pleasure on behalf of all of us here today to unveil this tombstone.
Minister Abel said the government will continue to partner with the church. He made a commitment on behalf of the Alotau district for an MOA to be done up with the church so that the monument as a government asset is maintained. Looking ahead, Minister Abel hopes the monument will become a tourist attraction in the future. Deli Waigeno, National, MTV News.
The Australian High Commissioner to Papua New Guinea, Bruce Davis, contributed a grant of 7.2 million kina to Enga Teachers College yesterday. The money will be for the Enga provincial government to construct new classrooms and buildings for the college. He presented this yesterday in Warburg during his two-day visit.
The Australian High Commissioner Bruce Davis, when announcing the grant, was pleased with programs offered at Enga Teachers College. The college is 6 years in operation, but the model used is well advanced. High Commissioner Davis said because of the province's interest in education, he will increase the degree scholarships to study overseas to 15. He said the Australian government will also increase the elementary training scholarships to 25 for the Australian award-specific scholarship. He said the Australian government will also look into developing Enga province through infrastructure and ICT.
To see this as part of a broader engagement, a broader partnership, a broader package of support. Infrastructure is one thing. ICT, in a way, is infrastructure as well. But it's the students, it's the people that count in the end ever so much more. And it's for that reason that we do believe that where we can find opportunities to provide more support.
Enga Teachers College has two programs running side by side. They are elementary teacher training, which is a one-year certificate course, and primary teacher training, which is a three-year diploma program with inclusive education studies. The elementary teacher development program has a four-week upskilling program funded by the provincial government. Enga Teachers College have also rolled out ICT and built two computer labs. All these were supported by the provincial government and the Australian government for education development in Enga province. The High Commissioner said teaching profession at the elementary level is important and needs more attention. He also said that ICT will assist to push education up. Vasenata Yama, National MTV News, Warburg.
Sir Peter Ipatas has told the people of Enga that he has a strong vision for the province to become the country's education and health hub. He said this during the visit of the Australian High Commissioner to PNG, Bruce Davis, to the Enga Nursing College this week. The High Commissioner handed over an AUSAID-funded female dormitory and a dining hall to Enga Nursing College.
The Australian High Commissioner to PNG, Bruce Davis, paid a two-day visit to Enga province this week. His visit was to strengthen the relationship with Enga provincial government in supporting the province in health and education. He visited Enga Nursing College at Sopas and handed over their funded projects to the college and the provincial government. The Australian government, through Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade, partnered with Enga provincial government and constructed a female dormitory and a dining hall for 4.5 million kina. Enga Nursing College, which used to be Sopas Nursing College, is home to 123 students from all over PNG.
Interested to hear of the future plans that there are for further development of the site. Working alongside the hospital obviously is very, very important, and you know, the more that there is continuing scope to really meet the dream.
Enga Governor Grand Chief Sir Peter Ipatas said Enga is beginning to fulfill its mission to become the education and health hub for the country. He encouraged his people to change their attitudes to allow development to take place. Sir Peter said in 20 years' time, his vision for Enga to become the education and health hub of the country will be fulfilled.
4 years ago, we said we had a college, but we didn't have a college, right? Now we can confidently say that we are getting there. We are not there yet, but we are getting there. I think we are on track. We are on track, huh?
The nursing college is in its fourth year of operation, after being closed for more than 20 years due to tribal fighting. It will have its first graduation in June this year. Starting next year, the school will partner with Pacific Adventist University and offer bachelor courses for nursing. Vasinata Yama, National MTV News, Warburg.
Nominations for the national general election opened at 4 this afternoon. Governor Paul Spakop was the first to nominate in NCD to defend his seat. He is also the leader of the Social Democratic Party.
Governor Paul Spakop was the first candidate to nominate to defend his seat in NCD. Prior to his nomination this afternoon, Governor Spakop rallied with supporters at Jack Pidik Park. NCD TVET-sponsored students attending private institutions and associations came in numbers to witness the occasion. Governor Spakop told supporters that despite challenges, he was firm in making decisions to develop the city.
And continue our journey of transformation. Support the Algonquin Yubla East, now West. Yubla is confident, very confident, that we can win this seat again.
Spakop also received contributions from generous private institutions for his nominations as a token of appreciation.
Okay.
Dunka Rukma, National MTV News.
And now looking at our finance news, the kina closed unchanged at 0.3145 US dollars in the interbank market. At Bank South Pacific, your kina was buying 0.3070 US dollars, 0.4070 Australian dollars, 0.2844 euro and 33.19 Japanese yen. Looking at commodity prices at New York close, copper closed higher while gold, coffee and cocoa closed the day lower. Crude oil closed higher while palm oil and copper closed the day lower. And on the stock market, the Dow Jones closed at 118.79 points lower, the ASX closed at 17.39 points higher, and the All Ordinaries closed at 14.48 points higher. Lay police arrest escapees from Bwimo Jail and a preview of UNITEC graduation tomorrow. Those stories after the break. Welcome back to the news. Lay police have arrested a man who was among the others who escaped at Bwimo Jail in 2015. The man was in remand awaiting trial for armed robbery when he escaped. Lay Metropolitan Commander Chief Superintendent Anthony Wagambi Jr. says he is wanted for a string of robberies whilst on the run. The escapee took cover as an employee of a major manufacturing company in Lay when he was arrested.
Police had received information of the escapee's whereabouts and conducted a dawn raid at his house and was told by his wife that he was on night shift. Police went to where he was working. However, when the suspect knew that police were after him, he tried to escape but was captured. He is now back at Bwimo Jail and will be charged for escaping. Police Intelligence Team and the Criminal Investigation Division, or CID, are continuing to work in allocating and rounding up wanted escapees. Wagambi says Lay has a large number of escapees still on the run from the mass breakouts in 2015 and 2016. A large number of escapees were already apprehended due to the support from the community in supplying information and through good detective work. Mata Lewis, National MTV News, Lay.
Over 900 students will be graduating from the PNG University of Technology tomorrow in Lay. The batch includes four foreign postgraduate students. Two are from Solomon Islands, one from Jamaica and East Timor. The first batch of a pioneer program at the university will also graduate with their Masters of Arts in Organizational Leadership. Preparation is underway at the PNG University of Technology for their 49th graduation ceremony tomorrow.
The graduation fever is high at the PNG University of Technology in Lay. Students, parents and family members are preparing to witness the 49th graduation ceremony tomorrow. 966 students will be graduating, including students with postgraduate degrees.
There may be a few more, maybe 970, but the total number that I am aware of, including the postgraduate and undergraduates, it's 966 at this very moment.
The university has faced many challenges over the past months, with economic being a major factor. But this has not stopped the institution from operating. The university will graduate 50 postgraduate students, including a PhD student tomorrow.
It's from the Department of Communication and Development Studies. In that department, I'm advised as a national and graduating year with PhD is the first one.
Among the postgraduates,
we are graduating four international students under two different scholarships. We have a Kapim scholarship and we have Bula scholarship.
Julie Badui Owa, National MTV News, Lae.
Each party of the Buka Airport redevelopment project will now have a clearer understanding of their roles and responsibilities as sealed out in the new Memorandum of Understanding. The document signed today between the National Airports Corporation and the Autonomous Bougainville Government will enable these parties to remain committed until the completion of this high-impact project. Fabian Hakalitz brings us this story from Buka.
The Memorandum of Understanding spells out the commitment of each party to proceed with the project and to ensure there are no disturbances. One of the complex issues is with landowners and others, which will be managed by the Autonomous Bougainville Government.
For NAC, we are going to provide the facilities, we are going to build the extended runway, we are going to build a terminal, the fencing is in progress, and that is what we are going to do. Under the funding of the Civil Aviation Development Investment Program. And the MOU basically states that ABT needs to support NAC in terms of managing mainly the landowner issues.
A coordination committee has been established and will use the all-inclusive approach to execute the consultation process between the Autonomous Bougainville Government and the stakeholders.
Chaired by the Secretary for Technical Services, Mr. Bernard Chilu, and we have also appointed the town manager, Mr. Eddie Kenai, to be the go-between person, basically the coordinator, talking to all the parties involved in this process and trying to bring everybody online.
Phase one of the airport development is now being undertaken, and we just want to make sure that all these problems that can deal to halting of the project is dealt with quickly.
Mr. Kennedy says he wants to see this project be completed on time and appeal to landowners to work closely with the coordination committee to iron out any issues that may strike in future. In Buka, Fabian Hakalitz, National MTV News.
Chuka Sports is next. Don't go away.
Chuka Sports.
Welcome to Chukai Sports. 2015 Pacific Games gold medalist in the 800 meters, Kaminiel Matlaun, was given a wake-up call in Lae this morning when he was beaten by Popondetta's Martin Orovo at the Sir Ignatius Kilage Stadium. Orovo, who won bronze during the 2015 Games, well-ordered the race throughout and held off late challenges from both George Yamak and Matlaun to travel home in 1 minute 57.6 seconds from Matlaun, who pulled in 1 minute 57 seconds and Yamak at 1 minute 58 seconds. This was the first 800-meter race for almost a year for all three athletes and a good measure of their fitness at this stage of the season in preparation for the international fixtures. Young distance runner Abel Sione from Simbu supported the athletes by locking a good pace of 57.6 seconds on his first lap round. To golf, just over 270,000 kina will be up for grabs in the 2017 Morobe Open to be held at the Lae Golf Course next week. Defending Morobe Open winner Damian Jordan will be among a host of former winners in the battle for one of PNG's most lucrative prizes.
Running from the 27th to the 30th of April, the Morobe Open is easily one of the biggest sporting events in Papua New Guinea. In 2016, a final hall disaster couldn't prevent Damian Jordan from an emphatic wire-to-wire victory. Jordan withheld the early challenges over the opening nine, holding a four-shot lead heading into the 18th hole. A double bogey wasn't the ideal way to seal the win, though his final round 70 would be good enough for a 17 under the card total and a two-shot victory over Simon Houston. Jordan was challenged early by Josh Caban and Simon Houston. Unfortunately, their challenge was short-lived, as Jordan remained steady throughout the final round. His bogey-free round of 8 under 63 matched a Le Golf Club course record, which was held by Michael Wright and Brad Burns. And that 2016 win was the biggest of Jordan's career that year. In 2015, Daniel Nisbet fought through a three-hole playoff to claim the Open. And this year, along with a host of frontrunners in the current 2017 season, will be a favorite. Almost 60 professional golfers have registered for the Morabe Open, with 72 holes played over 4 days of competition. Jeremy Mogi, National TV Sports.
A team of 5 athletes and 1 coach for the Court of Table Tennis arrived back in the country on Monday after attending the Oceania Championships in Fiji. Coach Rea Loy said table tennis has made him proud after winning 1 bronze and silver.
Winning bronze in the under-18 men's division and 1 silver in the team event, team coach Rea Loy said winning the 2 medals at the Oceania Championships in Fiji was a great achievement in itself for PNG Table Tennis Federation. He said the team of 5 made up of 3 under-18 men's, Albert Lolua, Moga Agari and Jeffrey Loy, and 2 para-athletes, Vere Nime and Hauda Agari, all performed to their expectations and couldn't be any happier. Mr. Loy said the win in the Oceania Championships is the highest achievement for PNG table tennis.
As a coach, I'm very, very happy with the results that we have achieved during this championship. Actually, the championship, this is in Oceania Para and Junior Under-18 Championship. So it's organized by the International Table Tennis Federation, and we are very, very happy for the results that we have achieved. And this is first of its kind that table tennis has scored a medal.
Rea said the team will have to go back to do more training in preparations for the upcoming international events. Loy said PNG beating other Pacific Island countries and coming third behind Australia and New Zealand says a lot about the performance of the PNG side. No stranger to international meets is Jeffrey Loy, who also did outstandingly in the event, said he was very proud and happy about the team's performance.
I'm very, very happy because this is the first time that Team PNG got a bronze in the Oceania Cup and the Juniors Championship. This is the first time we got bronze, and our para got 1 silver and a bronze.
Godwin Eki, National MTV Sports.
Chukai Sports continues after the break. Stay with us.
Chukai Sports.
Welcome back to Chukai Sports. The Sports Awards nominations closing date has been extended for another 2 weeks, according to the organizing committee. The initial closing date was April 13th, which has expired last week Thursday, with the new deadline set on 28th of this month.
The committee has extended the deadline to give ample time for entries to come in before the closing date. For the general public, the extension allows for those who may have missed the initial date to still send in their nominations. According to organizing committee chairperson Andrew Ranawiri, the nomination gives the opportunity for people to participate in nominating their sportsmen and women in any of the categories on offer. Whilst the nomination covers a wide range of categories, which includes athletes, officials, media, organizations, programs and athletes living with disability, Ranawiri said the committee is yet to receive nominations for the category of Best Sportsperson with Disability. The organizing committee is now urging on the general public to show their appreciation and support by participating in the nominations. To nominate, you can check out the PNG Olympic Committee website and Facebook or Twitter pages for nomination form. This year's SB Sports Awards also marks the 25th anniversary, in which the organizing committee is anticipating an exciting celebration with more participation from the public by way of nominations. Shane Saroya, National MTV Sports.
To NRL, the round 8 will kick off tomorrow evening with the opener match between the Canberra Raiders and the Manly Sea Eagles. Later tonight, the Rabbitohs will take on the Brisbane Broncos. While the Rabbitohs fight to stay in the top 8, the Broncos continue to rise on the Telstra Premiership ladder. This match will see Rabbitohs captain Sam Burgess, who escaped a 2-week ban, out to prove himself.
The ball back somehow, some way, the Tigers.
In other matches, it's on again for old rivals, the Parramatta Eels and the Penrith Panthers this Saturday. With 5 losses in 7 games, the Penrith guys are expected to fight for a win this time. Although the Eels have a lineup that is identical to the lot that beat the West Tigers on Easter Monday.
Staring down the barrel of...
On the other hand, the Cowboys are already receiving positive vibes as they have been tipped as the most likely winner in the match against the Knights. Knights, however, are at the negative end considering the Cowboys' good form, but that may not be the case with the Cowboys' injury list growing.
Sean Kenny Dow was up quickly. Kencio...
And the 2016 Premiers, Cronulla Sharks, are expected to give the Gold Coast Titans a run for the money with a defence that is unbreakable at times, as proven by the matches against the Storms and the Panthers in recent weeks. With the possible return of Jared Hayne and Conrad Harrell from injury, there may still be hope for the Titans. To conclude Round 8, the Storms will meet Warriors in the annual Anzac Clash, while Roosters will go up against the Dragons, and West Tigers will face the Bulldogs. Dinero Strico, National MTV Sports.
And that ends True Kai Sports. The weather details when we come back.
True Kai Sports.
The weather details are proudly brought to you by Dulux Weather Shield. Worth doing with Dulux.
Your weather forecast for tonight and tomorrow: in the southern region, cloudy with rain and showers imminent in Port Moresby, cloudy with some showers and possible thunderstorms in Daru and Kerama, cloudy with chances of few afternoon showers in Alutau, and overcast with rain and showers in Popondetta. In the Momase region, cloudy with rain and showers occurring, with possible thunderstorms in Leh, cloudy with a shower or two in Medang, cloudy with showers developing in Wewak and Vanimore. In the New Guinea Islands region, cloudy with occasional showers developing in Laringau, becoming cloudy with chances of rain and showers developing in Kavieng, Kokopo and Rabaul, and cloudy with showers in Kimbe and Buka. And in the Highlands region, cloudy with chances of rain in all centres.
The weather details are proudly brought to you by Dulux Weather Shield. Worth doing with Dulux.
Now recapping our main stories for tonight. 2017 elections now open. 2012 election service providers renew calls for payment, and nominations open in sounds, colour and numbers. And that's been the news, sports and weather for tonight. On behalf of the entire MTV News team, I'm Helen Sayre. Pleasant viewing. Good night.